Hey guys, it is ya boy Chili here. Welcome back to Hardware 3D. Today we're going to be looking at cube maps, and we're going to be using cube maps to make a skybox. So the basic idea of a cube map is you have, you know, textures, 2D textures. You take six of them, you map them to the faces of a cube, and then you use that cube to sample. What does that mean? Well, take a look at this picture here. This is something you might have seen something like this before. This is a texture that is used for cube mapping. It could be for an environment map or for a skybox. So you got these different parts of the texture, and these are just all mapped to faces of a cube. And this can be used to draw the environment, you know, surrounding a player or whatever in a game. So how does that work? How do you actually sample into a cube instead of sampling into a 2D texture with UV coordinates? Well, you have a cube like this. All you need is a three-dimensional vector. You point that vector out from the origin. The cube is assumed to be centered around the origin, and you got a vector coming out of that, and that is going to intersect with some place on the cube. And that is going to correspond to, first of all, it's going to correspond to one of these textures here, one of these 2D textures. And inside of that texture is going to correspond to a texel. So you create a cube texture like this. You give it six textures in a kind of an array. And then you have a special sampler, and you can sample into it and get the correct texel given an input vector, a three-dimensional vector, instead of your normal two-dimensional sampling for a normal two-dimensional vector. Couple of things to note. First of all, the length of this vector doesn't matter. The length of the vector used to sample doesn't matter. Only its direction matters. So very short, it will still calculate the correct intersection point. That's no problem. And the size of the cube also doesn't matter. You make these faces, you know, much larger. It's still going to intersect with the same texel. You could actually do this stuff manually. You could just take an array of 2D textures, and then given the sampling vector, you could first determine which of the faces the vector is intersecting with, and then you could map that 3D vector into UV coordinates on that face, and then sample into the texture manually. But, I mean, that would, first of all, just what I described there would be a big pain in the butt. And also, what if you sample on an edge? You'd actually have to sample, if you're doing bilinear filtering, you'd have to sample textures from two different textures and then blend them together. You couldn't do that just automatically with the bilinear filtering that is implemented in the hardware. So it'd be a really big pain in the ass. Luckily, you know, Direct3D, OpenGL, and the underlying hardware support cube map textures do that stuff automatically for you. So to do this, we're going to need a cube map. And we're going to need 3D vectors that are used to sample into it. So how do we generate those 3D vectors? Well, I mean, it's not that complicated. How do you generate vectors for sampling into a 2D texture? I mean, you've got some geometry. Geometry has vertices. And to these vertices, we assign UV coordinates. And then when we render this, we're going to, you know, we transform the position of the vertices. But the UV coordinates, you know, they stay the same. And then those are passed into the rendering pipeline. They get interpolated across the screen space. For every pixel, you're going to have UV that's interpolated between the UVs of these different vertices. And then that UV is used to look up into a texture, which is used to determine the color of that pixel. This should not be news to you by this point. Let me just say that. And it's the same idea for doing this in a cube map. In a cube map, you're going to need to sample with 3D coordinates. So you're going to assign to the vertices of your geometry three-dimensional coordinates. We'll just call them X, Y, Z. And then when you rotate your geometry based on where the camera is facing, the positions, screen space positions of those vertices will change. But these coordinates here, X, Y, Z, for the sampling, the cube map sampling, they won't change. And then once you have these vertices here for cube map sampling, it's going to be rendered, the geometry will be rendered to the screen, and this attribute will again be interpolated across the face of the geometry. That will be used to look up. That'll give you, you know, some kind of vector. That vector will be used to look up into a cube map texture, and then that returned value will be used to color that pixel. So we just need some geometry to generate these vectors. And because an environment map, not environment, a skybox should surround the player all around, the geometry that we use to generate those vectors should also be something that can basically surround the camera. So we generally want to use a cube. You could even go simpler. You could probably use like a tetrahedron or whatever, but a cube is fine. We'll use a cube. Now, last question here I just want to talk about before we get into the implementation is, when should we draw our skybox? Should we draw it before all of our rendering, or should we draw it afterwards? That's an important question. If we draw it first, some things become very easy. So if we draw our skybox, we render that all out, and then afterwards, we draw our geometry, then everything will be fine. Occlusion and everything will be good. We render our skybox. We're not going to do any depth testing, and we're not going to write depth. So after that, normal rendering will be fine. Everything will render on top of what we rendered for our skybox. Problem with this is that we have to render our skybox now for every pixel on the screen. And when you think about it, in most scenes, most of this, you're not going to be looking at the sky that much. Unless you're spending a lot of time looking up, you're probably not going to see much of the skybox. It's all going to be occluded by the ground and by objects. And so, you know, all these pixels that are behind things, you rendered them for no good reason. They could have been early culled by depth culling, and you could have saved yourself some, you know, texture lookups and stuff like that. The other solution is, of course, render your geometry first and then render your skybox afterwards. Now, the problem with this is that we're going to be using some kind of geometry to generate the skybox, probably a cube. And so you've got your camera inside of the cube. Let's say here's your view frustum. Obviously, if your cube is too small, the depths that are generated from this geometry rendering, those depths are going to create a problem. You're not going to be able to render your objects that are past that point of the cube. The depths will be too small, these objects will be culled, and you'll just see the sky. That's no good. Now, you can make your cube larger, and as long as it's large enough to encompass all of the visible objects in the world, everything should be fine. Except if you make it too large, now it's past the far plane, and you're going to have, you know, issues with culling for the far plane. So now you're thinking, well, I got to adjust my projection matrix and everything. And that just starts to get annoying. Remember what I told you. Sampling in the cube texture, the length of the sampling vector and the size of the cube don't matter. Different sizes, different vector lengths, you'll still sample the same texel. So the size of the cube shouldn't really matter except for this depth issue. Ideally, I would like my rendering to be independent of, you know, the size of my view frustum and closeness of my objects. I don't want to have to twerk around and tweak around with the size of my geometry here for the skybox. I just like to choose a simple geometry, maybe just a unit cube, and that should just work. So what is the essential problem here? Well, we only want to draw the skybox in places where nothing else has been drawn. So anywhere where an object has been drawn, we want to skip drawing the skybox. How do we do that? Well, we know that when we clear a depth buffer, we're going to set it equal to 1 for all the pixels. So we can say, okay, if the depth buffer is equal to 1, that's a virgin pixel. That pixel is a candidate for having its color overwritten by the color sampled from our skybox, from our cube map texture. So what we're going to do is, in our depth test, we're going to test for pixels that are equal to 1. And only those pixels we are going to write color. We're not even going to bother writing depth because the skybox texture is the thing that's drawn last. But we're going to test for pixels that are basically, is this a virgin pixel or not? And the way we do that, we need a value to compare with the depth on the screen. And the way we do that is, we're just going to set the depth for all of our geometry here. We're going to set the Z such that when the perspective division happens, the result will equal depth of 1. And then we're just going to compare, you know, is the depth of our geometry, which is always equal to 1, equal to the depth on the screen? If so, that's a virgin pixel, and then we render our skybox there. All right, enough talking, enough bad diagrams. Let's get into the code here. So here is the commit. Quite a few files changed. Quite a few files were added. First off, we added a skybox. It is space, the final frontier. So these 6 images are going to form the skybox. Then we're going to, you know, we have vertex shader, pixel shader, cube. I reinstated our geometry generating for a cube. It's very simple. It just generates a cube with, apparently each side is 0.5. So the cube's dimensions, width, height, are all 1. So it's a unit cube. And note, all we need here is position, because the position of the vertex is the 3D vector that we need for sampling. So we don't have to have a separate UV coordinate or whatever. We just need position on this bad boy. I guess the next piece of the puzzle is the texture, the cube texture. It's going to be obviously a different texture than your normal 2D texture. So we create a new bindable, call it cube texture, give it a constructor, give it a, got to have a bind function, obviously, slot. None of this is should be too amazingly surprising for you. For the constructor here, we're going to take in a path. That path, the folder that that path points to, is going to have the 6 images. And they're just going to be labeled with numbers, 0 through 5. And that's how it is going to load the 6 faces of the cube. If we look at the implementation here, loading the 6 faces of the cube in a vector, we're just going to do a little string processing. We have a loop from 0 to 6. We load those into the vector of surfaces by concatenating the loop index onto the path. And then we get into the good stuff. Just like normal textures, texture descriptor is D3D11 texture 2D descriptor. So it's cube map is basically an array of 2D textures, so that it's still texture 2D. Dimensions are the dimensions of any of the faces. MIP levels, don't need MIP levels for cube map texture, at least not for a skybox. Doesn't matter, distance doesn't matter, I have already shown that. Array size, obviously, 6, because 6 faces on a cube. Format, sample desk, all this stuff is the same, usage default, shader resource bind. But here, miscellaneous flags, gonna have to set that to texture cube, right? So a little bit of a flag here, to indicate that this is gonna be a special boy. Then, sub-resource data, data used to load that onto the GPU when we create the texture. Gonna have 6 of those bad boys corresponding to the 6 textures in the array. And we just get the pointers to the buffer. We get the byte pitch. And slice pitch doesn't mean anything in this case, so we leave that bad boy. And then what do we got here? Create the texture resource. So we create texture 2D, we give it the descriptor. This is the same, right? Okay, now we got to create the view on the texture. Shader resource view, same here. Texture debt, we just use the format from this bad boy. Here, view dimension, we got to specify texture cube. So you got to use this one. MIP stuff doesn't matter. And you create that. And there you go. There's the whole thing done. And when you want to bind it, it's the same as binding a normal texture. Give her a slot, say how many, and you give that pointer to the pointer. You give him the pee-pee, and he puts the pee-pee in the thing and makes the thing go good. Yeah, that's how that works. Okay, so that's cube texture. Not very complicated. Not very complicated at all. What's next? Well, let's take a look at the pass object for our render graph for the skybox. So what do we got here? Well, it's a binding pass. It's not a render cube pass, because it's not, no jobs are being submitted. Only one thing is drawn, the same thing every time. So we don't need to submit jobs. It's just single binding pass, has a bunch of things that need to be bound to the pipeline. Like, obviously, we need that cube texture, stencil buffer, sampler, and I added a new mode to the stencil buffer called depth first. I'll explain that a little later. Rasterizer, skybox transform cbuff, that's another new thing that we'll explain in good time. Pixel shader is our pixel shader for skybox. Topology, triangle, that's fine. And then we got to generate our geometry that is used to generate our sampling vectors. So we make a cube, And here I'm transforming it. I made the cube a little larger because I was afraid that the cube would be too small. It would be clipped out from the near plane. But, and actually this isn't necessary and I remove it later on, you'll see. But yeah, geometry, load the vectors and indexes and all the good stuff. And vertex shader. Now we need to make sure that the main camera, the camera that is being used for the player's viewpoint, is the camera that's bound to the graphics when we do this rendering. Because, you know, we have a bunch of different kinds of passes. We have shadow mapping passes. And so we just want to make sure that the right camera is being bound. So we keep track of that camera. And we allow the outside world and render graph to bind a camera to this pass. And then that camera will be bound to graphics whenever we execute the pass. So we bind the camera, we bind all the things that are in the container, and then we draw indexed. Nothing amazing so far. All the interesting stuff is going to happen in the shaders, but they're not that complicated. So we have a transform cbuff, and all it has here is the view projection matrix. You might be saying, well, where's the model transformation in this equation? Well, skybox is basically always fixed in the world, right? You are in the world, you rotate, the skybox stays the same. So we don't need a model projection. So that's basically why skybox transform cbuff exists, because it needs less things than your standard transform cbuff. All it needs is the view projection matrix. So what are we going to do here? Well, we get in our position from our skybox geometry, and the output, two things. The world position, that's the vector that we're going to be using to sample into the cube map texture. So we just pass the position directly into this, and doesn't get transformed, and then it will get interpolated across the visible vertices when we render our cube map geometry. Position is, we need to rotate the in screen space, we need to rotate the vertices of our skybox geometry so that if we're facing backwards, different part of skybox is going to be visible. Obviously, that's what we want to do. So for that, we want to capture the rotation of the camera, but not, this is very important, we don't want to capture the translation. And a very easy way to do that is to put a zero in the W parameter, and that'll basically cancel out, nullify all the translation components of this transformation. So you'll only get the rotation part. Then down here, this is a very important step. We set the Z part, the Z component of position, we set it equal to W. And what this is doing is that when the perspective divide happens, and Z is divided by W, the result, if they're equal, the result will always be 1. So we'll always have all this geometry that's rendered will have a uniform depth of 1. And that's very good because we want that 1 to compare with what's in the depth buffer so that we can tell whether the pixel that we're rendering to is a virgin pixel or not. So there we go. We've got our vectors that'll be used to sample into the cube map texture, and we've got our depths, which will be good for our comparison with the depth buffer. In the pixel shader, couldn't be simpler. We declare a texture cube, not just a normal texture, you gotta declare it as a different object in HLSL called texture cube. Sampler state is just a standard sampler object. And then you just go text.sample, you pass it the sampler state, and you pass it three-dimensional texture to sample into the cube. And that's it, we return that. That's very simple. Then, as I promised, let's take a look at stencil. I added depth first for the skybox render. Why did I call this? Well, the idea behind it was that this stenciling mode is checking to see whether the thing that we're rendering is the first thing being rendered to that pixel. That's why I call it depth first. It's kind of a weird name in hindsight, but it is what happens. And so, for depth first, we want to do a comparison less than or equal. So our comparison value, the depth of our geometry, is always going to be equal to 1. Now we only want to draw if our depth, which is 1, is less than or equal to the depth in the buffer. So it's the depth in the buffer will be equal to 1 only if that pixel has never been rendered to before. And that's the only time that our skybox will be drawn there. Also, Right mask, zero. We don't need to write depth in this case. The skybox is the last thing being drawn, so I just disable writing the depth. Maybe it makes things faster. Maybe it doesn't make a difference. Who cares? We don't need to do it, so we get rid of that. And then skybox transform cbuff is very similar to your normal transform cbuff, except that the transformed, we only need the view projection here. And so that's a little simpler. And, you know, then the building of the matrix get transforms is obviously much simpler. We just get the camera that's bound to graphics, multiply that by the projection that's bound to graphics. That's your matrix. You bind that to the pixel shader and all, or the vertex shader and all as well. Okay, so last thing here, wrap it all up. How do we put this into our render graph? Well, we include the skybox pass here. Skybox pass, create it. Gonna link in the render target from our, you know, our normal pass here, the Lambertian, standard Lambertian rendering. It's a bit of a misnomer, but forget about it. And the depth. And then the next thing down the line, which is the outline mask, is going to get its depth stencil from the skybox. And the vertical blur pass will get its render target now from the skybox. So that's all linked in when we want to bind the main camera to our render graph. That will, down here, find the skybox pass and bind the main camera into there. So now the moment of truth. Does it work? Can we see the sky? And we can. And it's beautiful. But it's also kind of messed up here. It's kind of hecked up, bud. So, problems. Problems are had. Mistakes were made. But it looks like it's rendering properly, and it's just that the faces are all jumbled up. You know, that happens. It's kind of tricky to figure out, you know, which texture should be loaded into which index in the texture array. So, first things first. This page is a very good resource from, you know, the Microsoft documentation. This is a 2D texture array as a texture cube. So this shows you which faces, so this is the face corresponding to positive X, it has an index of 0 in the texture array. And the face corresponding to positive Y has an index of 2, etc. So you can use this information to figure out, all right, which indexes correspond to which directions relative to X, Y, Z, which is the most useful way of thinking about it. But you're going to download your skybox from somewhere. Going to be 6 images. It's going to be hard to figure out which ones actually correspond to where. What kind of convention was used to name them? So what I ended up doing was I ended up labeling the 4 sides of the cube map, not the top and the bottom, but the 4 sides, the left, right, top, bottom, and I also gave them their indexes that I was using them with, and that allowed me basically to track, okay, what's going on here? What is being mapped where? Compare my expectation to reality to see where the disconnect happens. So when you do that, it looks like something like this. We got right, 0, back. So this is right, this is forward, and this is left. So the mapping here, the names correspond at least to my directional facing, but the boundaries between the textures don't line up properly. So there was some shuffling here, but I used this information and I basically just inferred what the right order would be. So I went in, I fixed sides, basically texture 0 and texture 1 were changed. Left became right, right became left. And if you do that, now you see, okay, now it's much more seamless. There aren't these discontinuities at the edges of the textures. But if you look up, you'll see, okay, there's still discontinuities on the top, and the same as on the bottom. And if you look at it, it's basically just a rotation issue. This is the top texture, but either the walls aren't rotated properly around, or the top isn't rotated properly. Either way, you could look at it. So if you look at it like this, this corner here should, on the top texture, should actually be over here to match up with this bright portion on the sides. So a little bit of rotation required, a little bit of musical texture chairs. I could have done that by rotating the image of the top and bottom textures, but instead I decided, just rename the sides so that they match up. And if you do that, now you see everything is good. Skybox working properly. We are surrounded by the firmament of the cosmos. And it's beautiful. Yeah, good. So, I mean, obviously next step after that, probably want to remove those labels from the skybox. They're a little bit jarring. Then I did a couple small tweaks. Nothing interesting at all. I made the light start off pointing towards the nanosuit. And for the skybox pass, I did some move semantics. Instead of copying, we just move this stuff in here because it's not needed anymore. But that's it. That's basically it. And then you've got it. You've got it working. Now, there's one last thing that I just wanted to try out, and I'm going to show you. And that is online. I've seen a lot of like conflicting information about the geometry that is used to generate those sampling vectors. Now, when you think about it, I mean, as long as the vectors are mapped properly to the edges of your geometry, any geometry should be able to generate the vectors needed to sample into the texture. So it really shouldn't matter what the geometry is. It could be a cube. It could be a tetrahedron. It could be a sphere. A sphere seems to make sense intuitively, because when we think about like the skybox or, you know, the firmament of things surrounding us, it's kind of like a dome, right? Or a sphere in the way we sample it, right? Kind of like radial coordinates. So you might think, well, a sphere might be better, but it isn't. But I have seen online people saying that a sphere will give you better results, and that if you use like a cube, there will be issues with distortion and issues with the interpolation of your vectors. So I decided, okay, let's put it to the test. So what I did was I made it so that you can at runtime switch between a sphere to generate your sampling vectors or a cube. So what I did first of all, in this commit here, I broke it up into a couple commits here. Here we're generating the cube, but we're going to, instead of injecting that directly into the bindable container, we are going to store it separately. We're going to have separate bindables here for the cube stuff and the sphere stuff. So here we're just loading the cube and then drawing the cube. So we're manually binding those. And that's just set up for the next one, the next commit here, where we're also going to generate geometry for a sphere, store them in different smart pointers. And we have a boolean here, use sphere. So when we execute, we check use sphere, and depending on that, we're either going to bind the stuff for the sphere or we're going to bind the stuff for the cube. And then we're going to draw indexed, and we just have a very simple function here to render an imgui window with a checkbox to check whether we use sphere, and that will control this boolean, which will control this branch, which determines what is bound to the pipeline when we render our skybox. That's it. And then in the blur outline render graph, when we render windows, we're also going to resolve out our skybox pass and call render window on that. And here we are, our skybox. All the text has been removed. And I mean, if I look at, you know, some point on the sky here, and then I turn the sphere off, turn the sphere on, there's like absolutely no change. So the exact same vectors are being generated to sample into the texture. Does not matter what geometry you use. As long as it satisfies, you know, the minimum requirements, should be, you know, convex, shouldn't be too small that you get the front face culling, etc., etc. But yeah, there you go. So I just wanted to do that because when I did my research online, I saw conflicting opinions on whether or not a cube would give as good of results as, you know, a sphere or something like that. And, you know, from a naive intuition perspective, you might think a sphere would give better results. But when I thought of it, when I puzzled it out myself, I'm like, I can't see why a cube wouldn't be any worse, or would be any worse. So I decided, man, instead of, you know, puzzling it out and gazing into my navel for hours, just implement it, do the test, see, does it actually make a difference? And apparently it doesn't, unless I'm missing something. If I am, you let me know. But I think a cube will do you just as well. And you could even try it if you wanted. You could try it with a tetrahedron. My assumption is that it would also give you exactly the same results. And there you have it. There is our skybox all implemented. And I hope you guys understand a decent amount about how cube maps work and how you sample into them at this point. Because, you know, obviously they're very useful for skyboxes. Pretty much any game with an outdoor component is going to have a skybox. But that's not all they're used for. Look at this picture here. We got reflections. And these reflections are mapped onto this sphere using cube environment mapping. So that's one other way that they can be used. And another one, very important one that ties into what we were doing in the previous videos, shadow mapping, right? If you've got a point light, that light is, you know, putting out photons in all directions. So ideally, you want shadow maps going all the way around. Right now, we just have one shadow map going in a specific direction. How do you do that in all directions? Well, your shadow map becomes a cube map, and then you use that cube map when you are doing your sampling. And that brings us full circle now. In the next video, we are going to be implementing omnidirectional shadow mapping for our point light using this new cube map technology. Until then, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please click the like button, helps a lot. And I will see you soon with some more Hardware 3D.